So as a lot of you know, I'm a pretty big fan when it comes to using AWS Amplify for hosting my front-end applications. It doesn't matter if it's Next, Vite, Nuxt, or pretty much any other framework. It's a really streamlined way to get your projects running on AWS, where you don't have to deploy a CloudFront distribution and S3 bucket and all that good stuff. Now, as you may come to expect from a hosting platform, you can hook it up with GitHub, and then every time you commit a message, you can have that redeploy your application. Just to show that off, I'm going to take this sample deploy application and update some of the code for you. So over here in my application, we're going to switch this out, and instead of having some kind of link with a logo, we're just going to say, hey, how's it going? Now, once we have that in place, I'm going to save and then go ahead and push this up to GitHub. We have this new commit here. We're just going to say update message. And with that in place, I can view my project on GitHub. Here's the application. Once I refresh, you can see that I have the brand new commit message, updated message right there. Now, if I head over to the AWS hosting platform, you should see it redeploy my application. And there we go. It has my latest commit. It has the updated message. You can see it's building everything out. Now imagine a team scenario where you build out a bunch of Amplify projects. Wouldn't it be cool if you could have those all listed in a front-end application and then get real-time updates as they're building, deploying, succeeding, or failing? Well, that's exactly what I did. If I come over here, you can see that I already have the AWS Amplify console pulled up. But in addition, I have this sample deploy, which is the exact same repo name that I have running on the right-hand side in Amplify hosting. I also am listing out my other Amplify hosted applications. Now I can also come over here and view my repo, and that'll open up a new browser tab where I can see the repo, or I can check out the domain itself to check out the live repository. And just like that, you can see that it updated both in the Amplify console as well as in the Amplify health check application that I built. Pretty cool stuff. But I want to take a moment to show you the architecture before I demonstrate the code and how I put this all together. Over here in Excalibur, you can see that I'm trying to mimic what the actual setup looks like, where we have our AWS account, the application that I built, the UI, and then an event pattern that I'll talk about in just a moment here. But effectively, our application has a user sign in to Amazon Cognito. And from there, this AppSync application is going to talk directly to AWS Amplify. Now, this is different from signing in with Amplify. Here, we're talking about the Amplify hosting platform, the service itself. We're going to be fetching all of the applications inside of a given region. And that's how we list them out inside of our application. And what's really cool is that anytime your application deploys, builds, starts, etc., Amplify is going to put that event on what's known as an event bus, specifically Amazon EventBridge. And how EventBridge works is that you can subscribe to those via rules. This rule in particular is what we have on the right-hand side here. We're saying anytime the source is aws.amplify, which is what message is being sent from, and anytime the details in that message have a job status of succeed, failed, started, and the branch name is main, go ahead and trigger some kind of service. And recently announced, as you might have seen in my other videos, is that EventBridge has the ability to directly call AppSync. And what's really cool is that when an AppSync mutation finishes, our front-end application can subscribe to that and get a real WebSocket notification. Let's go ahead and dive into the code to get a better understanding of what's happening. Here, I have a basic Vite React project written in TypeScript. And I'm going to go to my backend CDK directory. This is where I'm defining all of my infrastructure as code. Inside of here, I have this lib directory where I'm defining my AWS services. Now, you might have seen in a bunch of other videos where I use Cognito as my sign-in mechanism. This is all boilerplate code, and I definitely encourage you to check out some of my other videos if you want to see how this gets set up. But effectively, the star of the show is going to be AppSync and EventBridge, where they are integrating with one another. Let's start with AppSync, and we'll check out our schema. This schema has the ability to do three things. One, it can list out my Amplify applications using a signed in mechanism, so long as that user is signed in with Cognito. In addition, we have the ability to have a message published from EventBridge. Now, EventBridge is going to be calling this, and we wanted to have the ability to pass in details relating to the Amplify event. And as I mentioned, whenever this mutation finishes, our front-end applications can subscribe to that via a WebSocket subscription. Now, the details of this event that is being sent from EventBridge is going to have a bunch of stuff on there, and we don't actually care about all of it, so we're just going to pick off some of the pieces that make sense for our application. But to give you a sense of what that event payload looks like, it's going to have an ID, the detail type, the source, account information, ARN information, and then the detail itself. So we can construct a rule based off of this and put it on EventBridge so that we can trigger our AppSync API. Now, before we actually check out the rule, I want to show you what that AppSync configuration looks like because it is a little bit different from when you're building out just a regular API for your front-end application. We're going to have this inside of here where we're having our default mode sent to set as Cognito. And additionally, we want EventBridge to invoke our AppSync API, so we have IAM permissions set up here. For troubleshooting, we are going to log events out to CloudWatch. And here's where things get interesting. When EventBridge calls our mutation, we don't actually want to persist data anywhere. So you can have a pass-through data source known as a none data source. Super handy when you just want to invoke a subscription. Additionally, when we want to fetch all of our applications from Amplify, we have this HTTP data source. So we don't even need a Lambda function to contact that other service. We can do it directly since we're all working with inside AWS. This is going to sign that request for us using SIGv4. And down below, I'm simply putting a policy on this data source so it actually has permissions to call this API method, list apps. Keep in mind that you have access to the full README if you want to deploy this. But just to show you what we have here, when it comes to listing out those applications, we have a simple GET request to this /apps endpoint. Now just look this up in the AWS SDK docs, and it seems like it's the right method here. So this will create a simple GET request on our behalf. And then in the response, this is what I'm saying, where we're just transforming this data to something that makes sense for our application. Now, when it comes to publishing a message, again, EventBridge is going to invoke this. It's going to take that data that's coming through as the context.args.input, and we're simply passing that through. So we have input coming in and input going out. It's never actually being saved anywhere. Now, how does EventBridge know to contact our AppSync API? And how does this rule get created? Let's go ahead and dive into that. I'm going to be using our default event bus right here. And right off the bat, we're going to give our EventBridge rule a policy that allows it to call our AppSync mutation. And in this case, any AppSync mutation, since we only have the one. Now here's the role that we're setting up, and we're passing in that policy. Now, as you may have noticed, creating an event bus is actually super easy, and every account comes with its own default event bus, which I'm bringing in right here. And then when you come to create an event bridge rule, that's really where the work comes into play. So at the moment, there aren't any L2 constructs to get this set up easily, so I'm dropping down to the L1 construct. So apologies because it is a little labor intensive, but that'll be updated shortly. I'm going to give it the bus. I'm going to give it a name. And here I'm specifying the pattern that I care about. Notice that the rule itself has the ability to look for running tasks as well. But in all honesty, if it started, it's kind of implied that it's running. And then I can just listen in on the succeed and failed events as well. I can also drop in any other branches. And then keep in mind that if there was a specific application that I wanted to listen onto, I could toss that in here as well and have access to just that application. And then to answer the question, how does it know to contact my AppSync API? Well, I can give it an ID and pass in the AppSync endpoint ARN. And the other main part here is that I can give it the specific operation to invoke when that target is matched with the given rule. Now here's the payload that you get from EventBridge. This is a direct copy from what we saw in the schema, but keep in mind that this payload has a bunch of detail listed in a nested structure. So I can use an input transformer to say, hey, I want to pick off various fields from this big object at various levels. You can see I'm diving into this resources array right here, which is what we have set up. From there, I'm going to go ahead and pass a stringified object here. And this is what's being passed into my GraphQL operation. In short, this is how you pick off the values. This is the input that you actually pass to AppSync. Once that's all said and done, we can head over to our application and see how we're stitching this together. We have our auth service. We have our AppSync API, and then we have our EventBridge operations here, both the event bus and the EventBridge rule. This is just a bunch of logs, nothing too crazy going on here. And on the front end, I'm using the AWS libraries to have my front end application contact my backend services. Now, nothing too crazy going on here. I'm really just going to cover this use effect and the subscription use effect as well. But this is what I have set up to list out all of my applications. You can see I'm just storing them in state. And then I'm subscribing, which invokes and creates that WebSocket connection where I can listen in on a subscription, subscribe to it. And then I have a regular for each loop here. One thing that I messed up on is that I used a map the very first time, forgetting that map is asynchronous. So when you have events coming in really fast, you can get out of order invocations. So I switched to a for each just to make sure that things are running synchronously. Outside of that, special shout out to the CLSX package because it just makes having my operations very easily conform to whatever status is being applied here. So give me a Tailwind class of a certain color when the status is started. And then as you can see here, different operations. And that's pretty much it. Once I had this all deployed, as you can see, I can go back over to my application, trigger a deployment right here, and redeploy this version. And you should see this update in real time. There we go. And that'll go ahead and provision my application, deploy it, and then this will turn back to green. If everything is great, I hope it is. Or it'll be red if something were to happen and it would be a fail event. So there's how I did a walkthrough of this Amplify health check application. Let me know if you like this format or if there's something specific that you would like to see. Repo is going to be down in the comments. And as always, Focus Otters, thank you so much for watching. I'll check you all next time. Peace.